Coming up, we celebrate National Aviation Day with a major milestone for the AOPA You Can Fly high school curriculum, and by taking teens flying.
A fly-in to a historic grass strip and flying around the Tetons. AOPA Live this week begins in just a moment.
This is AOPA Live This Week with Tom Haynes and Alyssa Cobb.
The future's looking great. Thousands of young people will get an introduction to aviation they otherwise wouldn't, as the AOPA You Can Fly high school curriculum is now in, get this, 300 schools across 44 states.
That's right, and the school year is starting across the country, and in 300 of them, the aviation-based science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, or STEM, curriculum is exposing young people to the bright future that awaits them in an aviation career. The curriculum features two pathways, pilot and drone. Once students have completed the curriculum, they have learned the principles necessary to pass FAA knowledge tests. Glenn Ponis is the director of the high school initiative. He says this is a very big deal.
That represents for us a growth of over 50% from last year. So we are now we went from 36 states to now being in 44 states. And it's a testament to the tremendous effort that's gone on both from the AOPA staff as well as the teachers who are teaching it.
The curriculum is funded by donations to the AOPA Foundation and is provided free to schools.
And a couple of students from Magruder High School in Montgomery County near us here in Maryland came to AOPA headquarters to go flying for National Aviation Day. Magruder uses AOPA's high school STEM curriculum. CFI Chris Moser showed students Peter Weiland and Natalie Webb around a Cessna 182 and took them for a flight.
Chris helped me a lot with flying today. It was my first time, so I was very nervous, but Chris did a really good job in assisting me and telling me exactly what I needed to do and when to do it, and I was able to effectively maneuver us in the air when instructed to do so, and I had a lot of fun, and I would like to do it again if I had the chance.
While Natalie flew for the first time, Peter is already a private pilot, and this is his fourth year in the aviation program at Magruder. His goal is to be a commercial airline pilot. He says the AOPA curriculum gave him a major jump start in his career.
It's helped a lot. Throughout my high school career, I was working towards getting my pilot's license, and the program really helped compensate on learning what I needed to know and getting me to where I wanted to go. And the Magruder program has been great, just making connections. So I know what I want to do, I know who to talk to, and how to get onto those next steps.
A network news crew from Scripps Media also documented Natalie and Peter's flight for a national news story about AOPA's curriculum.
And there's a weekend STEM camp coming up in Lakeland, Florida. The Sun and Fun Aerospace Center for Excellence is putting on a Go for Launch themed weekend. It's happening September 11th and 12th and is open to 9th through 12th graders. You can find out more and register on aceedu.aero. Now, last week we told you about the GIFT Academy at AOPA's headquarters in Frederick, Maryland. GIFT stands for Girls in Flight Training. During the week, many women made progress on their flight training goals. One person passed a commercial check ride, and there was even a first solo. Several women also added endorsements for high-performance airplanes and one tailwheel endorsement. A number of the women also passed written tests. Congratulations to all the GIFT recipients on their accomplishments last week. Way to go.
That's right. And a fly-in doesn't have to be really huge. Griffin Sluis Airfield near Youngstown, Ohio usually does an annual Wings and Wheels that brings thousands to their grass strip. COVID has put the brakes on that for the last 2 years, but they wanted to get friends together and celebrate the freedom to fly, even if there weren't hundreds of muscle cars lining the runway. AOPA Live's Paul Harrop flew out to join them.
We're in Warren, Ohio, northeast corner, Ohio, just inside Youngstown's Class Delta airspace, a little private strip called Griffin Sluis. The airfield was established in 1948. A local farmer decided he'd start flying, and a local aviation pioneer, Ernie Hall, gave him his license, and he put a strip in, and it's been here ever since.
if you want to get a little technical, it's pretty easy. It's not too bad. It's about 2,200 feet, and the wind for this weekend has been right down the runway, so it's been easy to come in, take off, and come in with a headwind, and it's just a great easy strip.
It's a perfect place to host a fly-in, and this evening couldn't be nicer.
It's gorgeous, just very scenic, looking down the runway, seeing all the airplanes and people doing some passes to check for deer, of course, and it's wonderful. Just perfect setting, sitting out here on the patio. And,
What is it about a place like this that makes people want to get together?
I think it's just the grassroots. It's just this is where aviation began, and it's just kind of full circle. Everybody gets an opportunity to, you land, taxi your plane up, tie it down, set your tent up, good to go all night long. You can sit around the campfire and have a good old time.
You can, solve the problems of the world, as a lot of my friends say. You swap all these lies, you have some beers, and talk about airplanes, you talk about anything related, the world, and all that stuff.
And all the flight activity catches the eyes of the next generation. Kristen Muse was driving by with her toddlers Liam and Isaac. They stopped to see the commotion.
What goes through your mind when you see that? Obviously, you got two little boys in the back seat. They gotta love that.
Heck with them, I wanted to come to see the planes.
I love it.
And that's what Griffin Sluice Airfield is all about, bringing people together around aviation. The hangar is filled with, stuff.
I like it because if someone walks in there, somebody can relate themselves somewhere to something in there. I can guarantee you cannot bring one person in there and they can't say, oh, you have one of these, or oh, I had one of those, or I remember this, or hey, you know something about that? And I love it because you bring somebody in and they teach me about stuff that I had in there, and I think it's pretty cool,
You meet all kinds of people. I've probably met, a half a dozen different people, and just one of those proverbial $100 hamburger kind of trips, but it's a little more special than that.
Special because of the place, the people, the history, and of course, sunsets like this one.
It's vital we keep these little grass strips, going, because this is what made it into the, huge everything that it is today, aviation-wise.
In Warren, Ohio, Paul Harrop, AOPA Live.
What a great spot. And right there on the field is the Ernie Hall Aviation Museum. He was a pioneer aviator and flight instructor from the era. In a future episode, go inside the museum that keeps his legacy alive. And when we come back, Joby goes public.
And flying around the West, AOPA Live this week continues. Welcome back. GA pilots worked together to bring unleaded avgas to San Jose's Reid-Hillview Airport, and Swift Fuels delivered the first 7,000 gallons of UL-94 to the airport this weekend.
It's important to reaffirm here that transitioning Reid-Hillview Airport to unleaded fuel has the effect of eliminating this airport as a potential source of lead in the blood of children or anyone else living near the airport. We understand that lead is harmful. We're glad to be taking this step towards eliminating lead at this airport, and we hope to accelerate a growing push by the aviation community and others to completely eliminate all lead from aviation fuel.
Swift Fuel UL-94 is approved for about 80% of the piston engine aircraft flying out there, including the training fleet at Reid-Hillview. Meanwhile, GAMI recently received an STC for a high-octane unleaded fuel that can be used in all piston engine aircraft. And the Piston Aviation Fuel Initiative, in partnership with the FAA, is evaluating several other fuels that might replace 100 low lead.
Well, if you want to take a flyer, so to speak, on the emerging electric vertical takeoff and landing market, Joby Aviation went public last week. It's the first eVTOL company to be listed on the New York Stock Exchange. That's expected to fund Joby through initial commercial operations. And the company just released a video to dispute the notion that multi-rotor aircraft are particularly noisy. Joby flew a variety of aircraft from a Cirrus SR-22 to a Bell 206 at about 1,500 feet AGL over a calibrated microphone. All flew at 100 knots. Joby says they set out to design an aircraft that mimics natural sounds like the wind in the trees. And Embraer has just flown its first all-electric aircraft in Brazil as a demonstrator to evaluate new technologies. The company says the testbed aircraft will allow the company to develop innovative new products that will operate on sustainable energy sources and reduce carbon emissions.
Well, another big order for Piper. The company just sold 20 Pilot 100i trainers to Fly Gateway Aviation. Piper 100 series are specifically designed for flight training. Piper took out a lot of the non-essentials like the baggage door, sun visors, and a side window to reduce the cost. Like Gateway has four locations in Pennsylvania and Delaware. It's a Liberty University flight training affiliate.
Pilots in most parts of the country never get the chance to fly in real mountains. But if you ever do get the chance to go out west, flying amongst the peaks is a spectacular experience if you understand the risks and precautions of mountain flying. Executive producer Warren Morningstar went flying with an expert last weekend.
This great or what? Winding around the peaks of the Grand Tetons in Wyoming, but it isn't the kind of thing you should try without first getting the proper training.
The key to proceeding up a canyon or en route is always give yourself an option to turn around.
Paul Liedebrand runs Stick and Rudder Aviation near Boise, Idaho. He is the factory-endorsed training facility for Kit Fox, and he specializes in teaching pilots backcountry flying skills.
But we will want to fly on one side of the canyon so that we have room to turn around. We might want to fly on the upwind or sunny side of the canyon.
Right.
That upslope wind or the thermals are going to add to your lift. Downdrafts in a canyon are really no fun. Now, the key to flying in a canyon is to make sure you always have room to turn around.
At this point, it's not an escape maneuver. It's just we're not comfortable. We're not liking the weather conditions. We're not liking the turbulence, and we're not liking the routing of the canyon, and we may have made a mistake, and so we're going to turn around.
Paul teaches pilots to fly at what he calls canyon speed. Now, that's something less than cruise speed. It may be a maneuvering speed or flap extension speed, depending upon your aircraft. You want a lower speed so you can make a tighter turn under control.
And typically, most pilots overbank, increasing the stall speed and the load on the airplane.
30 degrees is your target bank.
But when crossing a ridge, we want to always cross at a tangent to allow us to have the ability to turn away without a 90 degree turn, would be preferably about a 30 degree bank turn to turn away to in case you had a downdraft as you were crossing the ridge.
And cross over the flattest part of the ridge. That saddle or canyon cut just might be turbulent.
The saddle is a Venturi effect. Saddle is where the winds are increased.
Now, no matter how remote the canyon might be, there can still be wires across it. So look for poles on the sides of the canyon and...
Rather than trying to see the wires, the poles, and then if you want to cross over a set of wires, the place to cross over is at the pole. There's nothing that's going to be above you at the pole.
And how do you know if you're going to clear that ridge ahead of you? Watch the terrain behind it. If the far terrain is rising and the ridge in front is descending in your view, then you're above the ridge. and pay attention to density altitude. This day we are at about 10,000 feet density altitude down in these canyons. Now the Kit Fox is turbocharged and we still had a lot of performance, but a normally aspirated aircraft would have a lot less. Fly in the morning or late afternoon when it's cooler and have fun. Warren Morningstar, AOPA Live.
There are a number of mountain flying schools throughout the West. You should get that training before you try flying deep in the canyons, as you just saw. So, Alyssa, we did quite a bit of mountain flying last week when we were out in Driggs in the area out there, and it was spectacular. We had incredible weather, and we learned a lot, and we captured a lot of content that you'll see showing up on our various media channels and the magazines over the coming months. So look for more on that on Flying Out West.
Oh, that's great.
All right, that's our show for this week. We're glad that you are a part of it with us.
That's right. Leave us a comment below on YouTube or send us an email to let us know how you're celebrating National Aviation Day. And for our international friends, you're welcome to join in as well. We'll see you all next week.
And I have about 600 hours. I currently hold my commercial single engine land and sea ratings with an instrument add-on. I've been in the Air National Guard for about 9 years, so being an enlisted member, I knew that I wanted to continue a career in the Air Force, but I wanted to do it as an officer flying for the greatest force in our military. Fortunately, I was picked up to fly the F-35 for Montgomery, Alabama. So I own a Piper Cherokee 6 260, and we also have this Aztec right here, which I'm going to be doing my multi-training in. I use SiriusXM Aviation Weather because it gives me an added confidence in the kind of weather that I'm going to be flying into on long cross countries, from Florida to Utah and back multiple times up to Oshkosh back down. And so having a weather system like SiriusXM that I can rely on gives me a lot of confidence as a pilot.